Jesus, we just thank you for this night. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that you died on the cross for our sins. We thank you that no matter where we go, you are there. Lord, help us to focus on you tonight and give you the praise that is due, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Remember your promise, oh God. Dissolve. chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, you ransomed me. And like a flood, your mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone.
My chains are gone.
I've been set free.
At the cross, you gave us life again.
your sweet spirit that is here. And we, Lord, we are just grateful for all that you've done.
Yes.
Lord, we just come before you now with open hearts. Open your word to us. Show us. Show us what you want us to learn this night. And may we put it to practice. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Linda. So I hear there's been some discussion going on with those taking class credentialing. And they have decided, with my husband, which I think is a great idea, that the final will be next week as well as the lesson. Mm-hmm. So study up, guys.
That sounds serious.
You guys will do that. I know you do. We're on
the last chapter in the test.
Oh, yep. All in one day.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's better to get it over with.
Yep.
Don't you want to do a review?
No. Well, we do.
We do.
A few minutes before the test. Yes. It really works every time.
But it is, if you do all the chapter and unit review questions and review those and review the major points and the points on the side and answer the questions on the side, you'll be fine.
Mm-hmm.
You'll be fine. There's multiple guests. So we're on the next to last chapter. I feel like the boat's like tipping this way.
Yeah.
All of you guys are over there and I'm over here. But that's okay. Thank you, Paul.
I'll sit here at this table.
Thank you. We're on chapter 12.
You're so easy to kill them all.
Yes, he is. We're miracles today.
It's a miracle I'm sitting on this side.
Yeah.
It's hard for me. It's very hard for me.
So, different churches have different views on miracles. The majority of the mainline churches don't believe they are true, but the stories offer a moral teaching. And some evangelical churches believe that the miracles of the Bible are true and happen, but they no longer happen today. But if something God and other Pentecostal churches believe, that the miracles of the Bible are true and the miracles happen today, and I can verify that one.
Mm-hmm.
So, some people ask, are there any other sources other than the Bible that verify the miracles Jesus performed? And as a matter of fact, there are. In the Antiquities of the Jews, the Jewish historian Josephus refers to Jesus as a doer of wonderful deeds. And the Babylonian Talmud, which is a Jewish writing, acknowledged that Jesus did miracles, but they attributed the source of Jesus' power to do miracles to demons, just like the religious leaders of Jesus' day did. Now, they didn't deny that they happened. They just said, oh, he did it by demons. Interesting. But the gospel accounts don't mention all of his miracles. Can someone read John 21:25, please?
Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written.
Amen. The book tells us, the study book tells us, that the writers were very, very careful about, or the Holy Spirit, I should say, caused the writers to be very careful about which miracles they included. So what is a miracle? Now, in this church, we define it as something that goes against natural law. The book defines it, and since you'll probably see it on the test, the book defines it as the occurrence of any event that would not normally happen without the intervention of an outside force or power, which is pretty much what I said the first time, it just added a few more words. It can't happen on its own. It has to have a supernatural source. And there are two types, some people say three, of miracles. But the book says two. One involves healing. For example, the man with a withered hand. If you've got a withered hand, you don't all of a sudden get the strength to stretch out all those muscles and tendons on your own and say, oh, it was a mistake. Now I guess I'm okay now. It had to happen supernaturally. And the other ones are involving nature, like walking on water and feeding the 5,000. And there are some theologians that say that the deliverances are also a form of miracles. And yeah, we can go along with that too, because without, but the book only says two. But we can go along with three. They sometimes lump deliverances and healings under the same term, which is healings.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
So you have the teacher's book, and I see where it says if a miracle is any event that would not normally occur, but does it like this line? I like this line better, so
okay.
I'm just asking. Anything that occurs, which appears, and I particularly like this word, which appears to violate the accepted, unchanging laws of nature.
That's pretty pointed.
Yep. Do they not like that? Would they prefer the other one where it says an interference of an intervention of an outside force?
The occurrence of any event that would not normally happen without the intervention of an outside force or power.
So they like the second sentence rather than the first one.
Yes.
This book is very well written.
It is. It's very well written. Okay, so there are three Greek words that are for the test. No, the second sentence, but I'm with you, Deb. I like the first one better.
Yeah. I thought it was a little weird there for me.
So three Greek words are translated as miracle. The first one is dunamis, not to be confused with dunamis.
That's important.
Yeah, which is, it comes from the same Greek word. But dunamis is mighty works that emphasize the power of Jesus' supernatural act. The second one, and I'm not a Greek scholar, so I'm probably going to be mispronouncing this one, is tarada, which is wonders. And it stresses the effect that the miracles produced on the people, such as awe and wonder. And the third one, which I'm going to totally mangle, Samia, which is signs, the purpose of miracles, to prove he was the Messiah. So when you see in the Greek it's dunamis, that emphasizes the power of Jesus' supernatural acts, mighty works. Tarada, wonders. Stresses the effect it had on the people, wonder, praising God afterwards. And Samia, signs, which is what the religious leaders always look for, the purpose of miracles to prove he was the Messiah. So I forgot to put this one in here because I didn't highlight it, but I'll read it to you. When it said signs, it just clicked. Matthew 16:1-4 says, the Pharisees and the Sadducees came up, and putting Jesus to the test, they asked him to show them a sign from heaven. So if we know that the purpose of miracles, when it says signs, is to prove that he was the Messiah, they were asking for proof from him that he was the Messiah, which was pretty bold. And by the way, this is one of the few times that you see the Pharisees and the Sadducees actually agreeing on something. They both wanted to know. They both wanted to know, show us a sign, which is pretty cool. Because,
and then when he did, they didn't believe him.
Yeah.
I mean, I know.
But at least they agreed on something. That was nice. It's one of the rare times you see them both doing something together.
Well, it's just that's really more reflective of the Jewish mindset.
Yeah.
Which, you know, we have to understand in ancient days, the Jews believed in signs and wonders.
Yes.
Long before Jesus earth.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
So if he was to be the Christ, the Messiah, this is just duly accepted practice. It sort of goes, you know, there's your stamp. You can get in the door. You know? So I really don't think that was like a big question. I think it was sort of like a test.
Yes, exactly. Because he had done plenty of things in their presence before. They had heard of plenty of things. He was just, they were just kind of like, so come
on demand.
Right now. Yep.
Change the channel.
Yeah, really. and Jesus was having none of it. He just said, when it's evening, you say it'll be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, there will be a storm today, for the sky is red and threatening. You know how to discern the appearance of the sky, but you are unable to discern the sign of the times. Hello. An evil and adulterous generation, ouch, wants a sign. So a sign will not be given to it except the sign of Jonah. And then he left them and went away. Wow. Because he knew what was in their hearts. By the way, when people asked us to pop it up and do it now, we don't know their hearts, so we can't say things like that unless the Lord leads us to do it. Yes, ma'am.
So, at the very beginning of the chapter, I love this, but I don't know if you could expound on it. I really like this a lot.
Okay.
It said, you know, they're just talking about it. We found that parables, because this book said parables are miracles in words, but this is the thing, because it's about miracles, right? Parables permitted him to both mask truth from skeptics and yet reveal it to earnest seekers. Mm. That's sort of like interesting. I never thought of it as masking truth.
He did in the beginning of his ministry.
Oh, right. That's right. We even learned about that.
But towards the end, right, as he was in Jerusalem and he was being confronted by the Pharisees, the religious leaders, let's just put them all in one long sun, he was very pointed in his parables so that they knew he was talking about them. But in the beginning, he masked it. And he was the master storyteller. So much so that with the parable of the sower, see, the disciples had to go, Jesus, can we have a word with you? You don't understand what you just said. You know, even they at first didn't understand. But, he was not only doing that to just let the seekers know what was going on, he was actually fulfilling prophecy. Because I believe it talks about it in the book of Isaiah, that rough paraphrase, that only some people, they would listen and not understand. They would hear and not have a clue.
Oh, I remember that now.
Yeah. So, yes, in a way, that is kind of a miracle. I don't know of anybody who could do that in storytelling. But Jesus was awesome with it. He knew by listening to the Father exactly what to say, when to say it, and how to say it. And he knew pretty much how it was going to be received. And especially when he got pointed at the end with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, but pointed because his mission was to seek and save the lost, and he was going to, and he's a just God, and he was going to give them ample time to respond, even if it meant hitting them over the head with a 2x4.
Right.
And knowing that they wouldn't respond, but he's just. So, me, I would have been here, you're not listening anyway, and I'd go on to the next, but he still went. He still put it before them, knowing that they wouldn't even receive. So we have dunamis, tarada, and the one that means signs that I'm totally messing up on. I won't even attempt to pronounce. almost all the time. You see the people in awe and wonder. You see the mighty work itself. You see the sign. It's a sign that proves he's the Messiah. So, how many miracles are in the gospel? Well, don't worry, we're not going to list them all. There's like 2.5 pages or something.
Yeah, 36.
Yeah. Miracles are mentioned, miracles that are mentioned in just one gospel, there are 19. Miracles mentioned in 2 gospels are 5. Miracles mentioned in 3 gospels are 11. And there is only 1 miracle mentioned in all 4 gospels. Does anybody have a guess as to what it is?
5,000.
Because you looked in the book, right?
Of course I read my homework.
There you go. That's the only one mentioned in all 4 Gospels. And, you know, we can sit there and scratch our heads and go, well, how come? Well, why not all of them in all 4 Gospels? So let's review a little bit.
You mean, excuse me, you mean why weren't they all written in the 4 Gospels?
Yeah, why didn't every single...
Why did God choose this one in particular to make sure everyone wrote about it?
Well, I was just going to say, the different writers in the Bible, although it was all God-inspired writings, they all had their own style and or their own way of writing. That's why some of the Gospels are, everything's not equal length, as some of them are shorter than others.
Except for this one, that's what she's saying.
It's the only one.
Oh,
but why?
Maybe I'm misunderstanding.
Why don't we have all of the whole entire, all the miracles in every single Gospel? So tell me why Matthew, to what audience Matthew wrote?
Oh, the Hebrews.
To the Hebrews, to the Jews, to prove what?
Messiah.
That Jesus was the Messiah.
Messiah.
Mark wrote to the Roman Gentiles. It's the shortest book, but Mark's book is a book of action. Jesus is a servant of God, a doer who works miracles. That was his theme, or I should say the Holy Spirit's theme, as he reached out to the Roman Gentiles primarily. Luke was writing to the Greek Gentiles, and he presented Christ as a man. And in Luke 1:1-4, it gives us the reason why he wrote and to whom he wrote, which is Theophilus. And there are as many reasons or guesses as to who Theophilus is as Friendly's has flavors in theology. But it's not important who he was, it's why he wrote. Why did he write? He was writing an orderly account. And then let's look at John 20:30-31 to find out why John wrote, even though it's not a synoptic gospel.
Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name.
Amen. I love it when it tells you right there, why did I write? Bam. These have been written so you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. That is the reason why the Holy Spirit took John to write his gospel. So we have different reasons that the Holy Spirit put into these writers for them to write, different people to write to, different reasons for writing. And that's why in some gospels you have these miracles and in some gospels you don't. And over here you have in this gospel these miracles, and over here they're not even included, except for the feeding of 5,000, because they're doing different viewpoints. And I should say Holy Spirit-led viewpoints. And it's like the story I tell when people say to me, well, you know, oh, this isn't included in Matthew, it is in Mark, and they see it differently in Luke and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, okay, here's a birthday party. The girl is 6 years old, it's her birthday. Here's the father. The father is going to tell the story. I'm not much of a party goer, so I went in and I gave my daughter a kiss and I let her open the presents. The clown was doing his thing with all the kids and they were loving it. And then I went in with the guys and we watched the ball game together. I don't know why my wife has to use fancy china at a kid's party, but she likes to show off. That is the father's version. The clown's version. Those little brats. I am never, ever, ever going to go to another birthday party. I'm getting too old for this. I have bruises up and down my arms. Kids bit me. They bit me. They started tweaking my nose. They were pulling my hair. They wanted to wear my wig. They stepped on my feet. They spit at me. They punched me. I'm done with this. The only cool thing that happened was when the woman jumped up to save the punch bowl and fell into the pool. I am never going to do another party ever again. The little girl's version. All my friends were there. The clown was so funny. He was so much fun. He let us do whatever we want. And it was so funny when we pushed him into the table with all the food and the table collapsed and he hit the punch bowl and it went flying up into the air and my mother leapt up and grabbed it and fell headfirst into the bowl. It was the best party ever. I hope I have another one just like this next year. Now, because there are different accounts, does that mean that the party never happened?
No, just different details.
Just different details. And that's the same with all the Gospels.
It's like when I used to watch a movie with my children. And then the four of them would discuss it afterwards. And I'd be standing there going,
did you watch
it? I watched a different movie. Because they all got something totally different out of the story. So
exactly. And usually if it's in my house, son number two is saying, oh, here's the spoiler alert. Oh, I've seen this before. It's coming, it's coming. And the rest of them are like, if you don't shut up, we're going to punch you.
Yep.
That was my house. But yeah, it doesn't mean, just because people have different perspectives and are focusing on different details, it doesn't mean that it didn't happen. But what happens if the details of an account don't exactly match up? So there is some little detective work that we're going to do tonight. This is about the blind man or the blind men healed at Jericho. Now, some theologians think it's two different healings. And we're going to find out why when we read it. But most theologians feel it's just one. And we're going to get into that in a minute, too. So let's look at Matthew 20, 29 through 34. If someone could read that, please.
As Jesus and his disciples were leaving Jericho, a large crowd followed him. Two blind men were sitting by the roadside, and when they heard that Jesus was going by, they shouted, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. The crowd rebuked them and told them to be quiet, but they shouted all the louder, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. Jesus stopped and called them. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. Lord, they answered, we want our sight. Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes. Immediately they received their sight and followed him.
Let's read it one more time, if we can go back.
Two blind men were sitting by the roadside, and when they heard that Jesus was going by, they shouted, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. The crowd rebuked them and told them to be quiet, but they shouted all the louder, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. Jesus stopped and called them. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. Lord, they answered, we want our sight. Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes. Immediately, they received their sight and followed him.
Amen.
So I spent the last sentence.
So, when we read all three versions of this, you're going to see some what seems like discrepancies. So it's important when you have things that don't exactly match up to do a little detective work. So I'm gonna, you know, the typical who, what, where, when, why. So you should ask as many questions as you can with the who, what, where, when, why, how. And so I'm gonna do that tonight and you guys get to answer. First question, who, and I mean all of who, not just one who was mentioned in the story?
Jesus, the mm-hmm. two blind men, the crowd that told them to be quiet.
Mm-hmm. That looks good. What did the two blind men do?
They cried out to the Lord.
They said, Jesus, have mercy on us. Yes. What did the crowd do?
They told them to be quiet.
I think, does this one say sternly? Mine says they sternly warned them. But what did the blind men do instead?
They said it louder.
Yes. I'm ignoring. I'm just going to get all the louder. And what did Jesus do at that point?
Stop what he was doing.
Yep. And what did he do to the two blind men?
Ask them a question.
Yeah, he called them over. He asked them the question, what was it?
What do you want me to do for you?
Amen. And how did the blind men respond?
We want our sight.
Mm. Why? Why did Jesus heal them?
Interesting.
Yes, for them to have mercy on them.
Yep. There are three, in my version, there are three key words here. It says, I've got to get to it. After they said to him, Lord, we want our eyes to be open, he said, moved with compassion. You won't find those three words in the other versions. But we're in Matthew, and why does Matthew write? He writes to tell us about Jesus being the Messiah, and he's showing them that Jesus is compassionate Messiah. So he focuses on moved with compassion, and the others leave it out. Because Mark is Mr. Action Man. And Luke is writing an orderly, is it Luke? Can I read? Yes. Luke is writing an orderly account showing God, Jesus as a man, doing all these wonderful things. But he's showing the Jews our Messiah has compassion. Mm-hmm. Okay, so what did Jesus do in Matthew to heal them? What action did he do?
He touched their eyes.
Touched their eyes. How did the blind men respond to being healed?
They followed him.
They followed him. When were they healed?
Immediately.
Immediately. Where, this is a key question, Where were Jesus and the disciples originally headed? Tell me the direction they were going. Close. In my version, it says they were leaving Jericho.
Yeah, that's what it says.
They were leaving. Now let's read Mark 10, 46 to 52.
Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, that is, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me!" Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet. But he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me!" Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet. He's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, Jesus jumped to his feet. Oh, he came to his feet. He jumped to his feet and came to Jesus.
Yep.
No worries.
"What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road.
Okay. Who is mentioned in the story?
Bartimaeus, Timaeus, son of Timaeus.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus, the disciples.
Yeah. And the crowd. There's only one blind man.
That's right.
Now, we're going to get to that in a second. What do we know about Bartimaeus that we didn't know before?
Son of Timaeus.
Son of Timaeus. What was he doing at the time?
Sitting on the road.
And he was
begging.
That's something we didn't know before. But yes, people who, you know, special needs people usually begged. And what did Bartimaeus do when he figured out that it was Jesus?
Yeah.
Yeah. What did the crowd do?
Shout. Shut up.
Drop paraphrase, yeah.
Please.
What did Bartimaeus do in his response?
What I would have done.
Yeah.
Continued even more. Louder.
Yep.
It was Jesus, that is.
Yes. And what did Jesus do in response?
Ask him to come over. Mm-hmm. To him. Near him. By him. Next to him. That's great.
And what did Jesus say to
him? Come here.
Yeah. And what else did he say?
He said, "What do you want me to do?"
Yep. And what did Bartimaeus say?
"I want to see."
And what did Jesus say in response?
"Your faith."
Yep. "Go, your faith has made you well." That's something that we didn't see in
the
other.
No touching. I don't see any touching.
No touching. No. No touching. How did the blind man respond to being healed?
Wow.
Yep.
Immediately.
Yes.
Same. Same in those two.
Those are same. Now, where were Jesus and the disciples originally headed? Way back in the beginning. Last time it says as they were leaving Jericho, this time it says
they're coming to Jericho.
So I'm going to get to that in the third one.
It actually says both in the same sentence here. It says, "Now they came to Jericho, and as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and the multitude," so they passed through. I mean,
I'll tell you.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Well, the other question I have is silly trivia.
Okay.
Is in the verse where Jesus was acknowledging that the guy was calling to him, but he told somebody else to tell the guy to come to him.
Yeah.
The guy's blind. How far did he have to come, do you suppose?
That's a good question.
But usually blind people on the side of the road have somebody helping them anyway, don't they usually?
It's true.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah, a lot of blind people. I knew a blind man that was friends with my parents. And a lot of blind people, they used to be in blind. They can move around with a stick or whatever, you know. They hear noises that other people don't notice.
That's true.
They smell smells that people don't.
Yep.
It's amazing, really.
And you know what? We're going to get the answer in the third one. Answer about Jericho. But this time you said, though your faith has made you well, something that you don't find out in the first one. But I'm going to answer the question about why do we know about Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus? Many of the theologians believe, the other blind person, he probably was there, but this guy, they only focused in on Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, they must have known him.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Yeah, they must have, either the father, was well known, and that's pretty much what the theologians are saying, that it was focusing on Bartimaeus here because he was well known in the town of Jericho or the city of Jericho. And so people, oh yeah, I remember Bartimaeus. He was blind, yeah. And I remember that. And then it says he got healed. Can you imagine knowing Bartimaeus? You're from another town, but somehow you know him. And you start reading this letter and it's like, wow, yeah, I know him.
Oh yeah, like the homeless guy that was a member of the grid of the companies for many years until they changed hands. Probably 10 years he was standing out in front. And he'd just say, hey, you know that homeless guy that hangs out in front of companies? Oh yeah, I know him.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh.
That, you know,
right?
Mm-hmm. So people, it was, this is somebody that you might know. And he's the one that appeared. And that's why theologians feel that Mark kind of went into detail, although he's not one usually for detail, that he went into detail because, again, Holy Spirit led, other people would know about this guy. So we've got coming and going so far to Jericho. Let's read Luke 18:35-43.
As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard the crowd going by, he asked, what was happening? They told him, Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. He called out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Those who led the way rebuked him and told him to be quiet. He shouted all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stopped and ordered the man to be brought to him. When he came near, Jesus asked him, what do you want me to do for you? Lord, I want to see. And Jesus said to him, receive your sight, your faith has healed you. Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. When all the people saw it, they also praised God.
Amen. There we go.
We add a little addition there.
Because he is the one who's writing an orderly account. You're going to get more details out of Luke. So who's mentioned in the story?
Crowd.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus.
Yeah.
The beggar.
Yeah.
They specifically mention the people in the front of the crowd.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
I noticed something else, but I may be wrong.
Okay.
It mentions in this account the people leading the way. Was that the people that were walking with the blind man? Perhaps leading his way to walk? Maybe they walked with him over to Jesus.
Let me look at my version here.
Look where it says the people leading the way. It didn't mention that in the other accounts.
Yeah. Those who led the way were sternly telling him to be quiet.
Okay, so that was maybe just the group of people there.
Yep. But to answer your question,
yeah,
when Jesus stopped and commanded that he be brought to him, that's how the blind man got there, because the people in the crowd brought him over to Jesus.
Okay, yeah.
The other one said he jumped up. Dropped his cloak.
Yeah, and then they brought him over. That's fine.
There you go.
And can you imagine being blind and hearing that Jesus wants to see you? Wouldn't you jump up?
Oh, yeah.
I jump up.
Yeah.
I can't do a whole lot of jumping, but I'd certainly try. I love it. So, we know about him that he's a beggar. We know he was sitting by the road. These are all the same things. He yelled for Jesus to have mercy on him, and the crowd told him to shut up. And what did the blind beggar do? He yelled all the more for Jesus to have mercy. And here's where Jesus called him over, and they brought him over, and he said, "What do you want me to do?" And the blind man responded, "I want my eyes to be opened," in my version. Say to him this time. It's a little. That's both.
He didn't see that. He said that to a lot of people.
True.
Not all of them, but a lot of them.
Well, the other two, I think they said your faith has healed you.
Mm-hmm.
And then he could see. Here it says receive your sight, and then it says your faith has healed you. So it just reverses the order.
It's the same. It means the same thing. A lot of people get really nitpicky with that. One version in my version says, "Go, your faith has made you well," and the other says, "Regain your sight, your faith has made you well." They're both saying the same thing, you're healed. It's done. Don't focus on the little tiny changes. It's saying the same thing. So there's something that we don't have here, that because Luke is a man of detail, that isn't in any of the other ones. How did the people respond to the blind man being healed?
They praised God.
They praised God. Yes, I love that. Amen, amen. We all should do that.
Oh, yes.
And they glorified God. When all the people saw it, they gave praise to God. That this is the third healing word, where people are in awe and wonder, and they're like, "Wow, praise God, look what happened." Because in Mark, we learn that people know who one of the blind men are. And now they're praising God, because if you know who he is, and you know he's been blind, because you've been going back and forth, and now all of a sudden he can see, wow.
Right, it doesn't mean that Jesus just healed one blind man. They just have to focus on. However,
yes.
I am going to say this on purpose.
Okay, go ahead.
Because I remember nobody telling me the name Bartimaeus. And I remember reading the book. And he is, he compares the timeline and finds every mistake in the Gospels. And it can dishearten anyone here, but I am going to say, because, you know, if you read, I needed scholars' help to refute Mark. He's got some really good arguments. And I only say that out loud, because I don't want anyone to be caught unawares, bit by the snake, so to speak, the serpent slipped. Because truthfully, I was so disheartened, and I only always research the opposite side of what I believe, so that I can be fully prepared to make a case for Christ. So he's a tough cookie. It's taken scholars who have gone to school 8 years and more, and been in the in the ministry 20 years to refute a guy like him. So for the general, he likes to pick apart things like this. But some of them are very difficult to reconcile, so to speak.
It is.
Oh.
Well, one of the things you need to know, especially with the coming and going here, are they coming to Jericho? Are they going to Jericho? That's the issue. The book talks about it. With archaeology and history, you can piece this together. There was an old section of the city of Jericho and a new section of the city of Jericho that in between was this road that they were traveling on. So you can be absolutely correct in saying they're going to Jericho because they're walking on this road to either the new city or the old, and you can say that they're leaving it because there are two different parts to the city separated by a road. And usually at the city gates, you will find the beggars. Makes perfect sense when you realize that when you travel in Europe, there's an old city and a new city. There's the old square in Timisoara, and there's the very modern city. Because unlike America, they like to remember where you come from. When you go to Thessaloniki, they did not allow the subways to go through certain parts because they found all these underground statues, buried underground. And so what they did in the middle of the subway station is they kind of routed the actual subway around all of these things and made the subway into a museum. So here we have our historical site, and but we don't do old city, new city. But in Europe and in the Middle East, they do.
They do in Canada, Quebec.
Yeah,
Quebec, there's the old city, right? So
yeah.
Right up the road from us, you can drive there. And they only speak French in that little section, the streets and the road there. And then there's Quebec, which is for today. And it's the regular city where they speak
to be things set out of order, and you'll see that in this book over and over again. The author constantly says that actually, I think he says Mark is the one that actually goes more in order, but Luke adds more details. And so when you understand that the Gospels are not written in order, except for Mark, which Mark kind of the Reader Digest version, I'm taking everything out but action. It starts when Jesus is a man, instead of his birth, instead of the prophecies, the whole thing is just Jesus is a man. Here we go. He's a man of action. Pay attention, people. But we know that in our hearts, based upon what he has done for us and the miracles that he has done for us also, I know know I'm not the only one that's gotten a miracle of healing in this room, that Jesus is exactly who he says he is. But when we come to these iffy places, we have to play detective and we have to look into the historical background and the archaeological background for answers. And next week will be a quick review by my husband on chapter 13. We'll do a quick review of the whole book and then you guys will take the test. And everyone went, oh. So who would like to close in prayer? Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this evening. We thank you that we can come together in your house and learn more about the Gospels. And thank you for giving us another day. We thank you for the Sabbath. I ask that you protect our family.
Goodbye, Andrea, Todd, and Marianne.